Good morning, the honorable speakers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rosa Chen from National Yilan University, Taiwan. Today, it's my honor and the prestige to be the moderator of this summer school. First, I would like to welcome all of you to this prestigious summer school about census held by IEEE Census Councils. In this summer school, we are going to have 9 outstanding presentations from our prominent presenters, whom I believe shall enrich our insights and knowledge regarding the theme of this summer school. Before the presentations begin, please allow me to introduce the host of this year's summer school, Professor Huayan Chen, the distinguished professor and the chief information officer of Asia University, to give an opening remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Professor Chen.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Huayan Chen. I'm the general chair of this summer school. On behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to welcome you to join the IEEE Census Council's 2021 summer school. The major theme of this summer school is intelligent computing on sensors and the Internet of Things. This activity is hosted by National Yilan University and Asia University. Due to COVID-19 epidemic, we changed the hybrid meeting to pure online meeting and postponed the meeting from August to September now. We invite 9 keynote speakers in this summer school: Professor Jason Lin Yiping, Professor Paul Zhao Changbo, and Professor Chen Jianzi from National Yangming Jiaotong University, Professor Huang Nenfu from National Tsinghua University, Professor Zhao Hanjie, and Professor Jian Weizhe from National Donghua University, Professor Pang Aijun from National Taiwan University, Professor Cai Chongwei from National Sun Yat-sen University, and Professor Wu Wenjuan from National Yilan University. They will share their innovative ideas and research experience on sensors and IoT technologies. We sincerely appreciate the financial and technical sponsors, including IEEE, IEEE Census Council, IEEE Taipei Session, IEEE Census Council Taipei Chapter, National Yilan University, Asia University, Kuangta-NCTU Joint AI Research Center, and the Taiwan Association of Cloud Computing. We would like to thank the advisory members who give us many useful advices which improve the quality of this summer school. We also thank the program chairs and the committee members for their great efforts on this summer school. In this summer school, we arrange the sessions in 2 days. This is the first day schedule. We have 6 sessions, and there is a lunch break after the second session. A tea break about 30 minutes after the fourth session. This is the second day schedule. We have 3 sessions only and will finish the summer school at noon. We hope you may attend all sessions, but if you are not available, you may choose the sessions that you are interested in. Last but not least, we hope that all of you will get some new ideas from the keynote speech from the summer school. Thank you.
Next, you will be hearing a presentation from Professor Yibin Lin. Professor Lin received his PhD degree from the University of Washington, the United States of America. Now, he is currently a lifetime chair professor of National Yangming Jiao Tong University. His research interest focuses on personal communication service network, mobile computing, and the system simulations. Today, he's going to give us a presentation entitled SpecTalk, Conforming IoT Implementations to Sensor Specifications. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Professor Lin.
Hello, my name is Yibin Lin. The title of this talk is SpecTalk, Integrating Sensor Specification into Implementation. Many smart applications have been developed with Internet of Things technology in large-scale smart city constructions. However, contract of intelligent application construction are often disputed in the acceptance due to the fact that the contract specifications are not clear. The higher the level of intelligence, the greater the controversy, especially when the customers and the vendors that provide the solution have different imaginations about the functionality of smart products. Such disputes often occur during the acceptance process of smart buildings, mainly because intelligent building systems are expensive and the operations of the subsystems are very complex due to the fast evolution of IoT technology. The classical method in contract law established a formula for quotation and acceptance in the 19th century, allowing buyers and the sellers to reach a consensus on contracts. Formal tests of customer requirements and the business processes are typically carried out at the time of acceptance to determine whether the system meets the acceptance criteria and to enable the customer to decide whether or not to accept the system. Flexible intelligent systems contracted in the traditional way are likely to be controversial for misleading conduct and misrepresenting the right to accept. This phenomenon becomes more obvious as the intelligence elasticity of the products increase in the era of rapidly evolving ICT. In light of the application situation and the demand for intelligent building energy management system, Taiwan Association of Information Communication Standard, called TICUS, specifies the data format standard of intelligent building, which is applicable to the data exchange between the subsystems and the devices under the integrated system monitoring platform, or the Integrated Operation Center, also called IOC. TICUS is developing an automated process to allow the IoT applications to be conformed with TICUS specification. TICUS is sponsored by Ministry of Economy Affairs Taiwan, which is an industry organization founded in 2015 with a member from industry, research and academia organization in Taiwan. Okay. Seven technical committees have been chartered focusing on advanced mobile telecommunication, network communication, device interworking, audio, video, and visual service and communication, network information security, intelligent building, and the vehicle stop. Okay. And proposed by myself, I'm the member of in the directors of TICUS. We are developing an automatic process to confirm the IoT application with TICUS specification. This mechanism was the procedures have been implemented and used in some scenario we will describe later. Okay, so here is the specification for generators in Taikers. So the first thing is a device model, which is a generator, and then the device ID. Okay, you have some kind of generator, but they have different ID during the test. So there's also a format for device ID. And then there's a so-called device feature. Okay, so in the generator, there is a tank oil label status. There are battery status and so on. And here is the name of the feature. Okay. Tank oil label status is a feature of generator. We also give a short name, oil STS. And we are specify whether it's an input that you can read or an output that you can write. And then that's the data type. We call it the DL parameter. Okay, to specify whether it's a Boolean, an integer, or a float. Now, here is the process to create those specification to a specific vendor device. Okay, and in the platform, there are several components: the device feature management, device model management, device application generation, and the database and the test engine. Okay, from the specification of an IoT device, which is number one, we already go through it. Then we store its software configuration in the spec talk database, which is number three here. And it's a such storing, it goes through the number two, device feature management and the device model management. Okay, and that's how we do it. The configuration is used to automatically create the sensor actuator application interface. Okay, so number six here. And then you can bind the IoT device, the actual generator, okay, to the tester procedure. Okay, so the whole thing is an automatic process that you can create the interface that can execute in the IoT devices and the test. The spec talk database will be maintained in a neutral third party, for example, Taikers, and can be freely accessed by both the buyers and the sellers to create their contracts and acceptance test procedures for IoT applications. SpecTalk is a web-based platform which can be operated in any computing device with a browser. For example, you can do it through a smartphone. Okay. In this platform, the configurations of IoT devices are stored in the database through the web-based device feature window. Okay, and then what we do is to create and store all device features of an IoT device using device feature management. And this is a SpecTalk GUI for device feature management. You can run it on a browser like a smartphone, iPad, or notebook. So first of all, you fill the short name, the oil STS, for example. And then you specify it's an input or output. And in this oil status, it's a read, meaning it's input. Okay. So in the spec talk, to distinguish whether a feature is input or output, we will append the name with I. For example, oil STS-I, meaning that it's an input device. And we also have a category field that you can put the specification that define this feature. And then you can put the data format for this device feature. For example, the oil status is a Boolean type. 0 means normal and 1 means low. Okay. Now you can put more information on the description field of this device feature. Okay. Now, after the DF information feeding is complete, the oil status DF computation is saved in the SpecTalk database. Okay. And then from the device feature management, we can go to device model management to create the generator model. Okay. So what we do here is that in this device model window, there is a table that put all device feature that already developed through the device feature management. Okay. And you can pick up those feature into your device model. For example, the battery status is part of the generator's feature. Then you select it. Okay. So in this way, after you select, you move up to the input device feature of the generator model. You do the same thing for all your status and the vent status. And after that, you just click save, and you will pop up to ask you what's the device model's name, and you say that it's a generator. So it's exactly the same as what we have in the Tyker's specification. Okay. And after that, there is a device model list. We will collect all those device models we have created. Now, after we have created the device model, then we can generate this SA interface for the real generator. What we do is the following. We'll move from the device feature and device model management page to an IoT talk page. Okay, IoT talk is an IoT device management system, and we can use it to create the SA interface for the specific generator. Okay, so what you do here is that you create a project called generator test. Okay, and then from the model list, you can find the generator. Remember that we already created a generator's model in the DM management. And then when you select a generator, you will pop up a window for you to specify the real feature for the generator you want to accommodate. Okay. So what happened here is that in Tyker's, we will create a generator model, which is most general one. And then for a specific generator device, you may have one or more battery status. You may have one oil tank. You probably may not have the vent. Okay. So you put, if you have two battery, you put two. You have one oil tank, you put one. And no vent, and then put zero. And in this way, you can exactly specify the real device you want to test. Okay. And when you click save, all those features you see there will go into this graphical representation. And then in this graphical representation, you may continue to set up the parameter for the real generator. Okay. For a different generator, the value for their parameters may be different. Okay. So here, for example, you want to change the range for the vent status, then you can click number one here, and you pop up the window, and you can do some modification specific for this device feature. And then after you save this generator graphical representation, then SpecTalk will automatically generate two software. One is called device application, okay, and then an incomplete call for sensor and actuator application, okay. The DA, the device application, is responsible for communication between the IoT device and the test, which is a generator in this case, and the test engine, which is in the SpecTalk server. Okay. And the protocols include HTTPS and MQTT. The lower layer communication can be Ethernet, Wi-Fi, LTE, or 5G. The SA, the service and actuator application, describe the sensors and the actuators of the IoT device. Okay. So the SpecTalk will automatically create the SA interface. And what happened here is that the breakline here is a template, okay, that already exists in SpecTalk. And then based on the generator model we specify in the IoT Talk project, the SpecTalk will automatically fill those yellow part on the code. For example, the generator is the number is GEN0012, it's an ID number, okay? And the device model name is generator, okay? And the device feature include oil, battery, and vent, okay? So this is automatically filled in this program, okay? And then there is a blue mark. The blue mark is a more detail that have to fill in by the vendor of the specific generator. And what happened here is that you have to key in to complete the SA interface. And SpecTalk automatically generate a graphical user interface that allow you to fill in all the information to create this SA interface. For example, the name is your device name. So if this is a National Jiao Tong University's generator, then you may have a generator, the name is generator for NCTU. If there is a generator for Asia University, then its name is generator for Asia University, something like that. And then you are filling the API, okay, for every specific generator. If it's a smart generator, then you will be controlled in the management software. Therefore, it has an API. Okay. Then you will tell the SpecTalk where is your API. So that's where you put the API, and the API will put in the SA interface program. So this is an example of Python SA interface. We also have the JavaScript version and C version for the SA interface. Okay. So in Python, what you do is that you import the API name provided by the vendor, equipment vendor. And then the oil status will have the API function. Then you just put the function here, and then the function will map to the SA interface, which is all your status data, and then put your function here. And similarly, for battery status, for vent status, okay, you just key in the function, and they will automatically include it in the program, okay? And when you have finished all this GUI filling, okay, then you can save it, okay? So when you click save, then the program will automatically generate. Okay. Then at the side of the IoT device under test, the vendor execute the SA interface call, which is this one after you have completed. And then you will register your generator to the device, to the you will register the device to the test engine. So here is test engine in the SpecTalk server. Okay. And then you can do the test and produce the report. And the test procedure is created as follows. Okay. Again, Remember that we have IoT talk project called generator test. Okay, and we already create the generator, and through the SA interface, when the vendor run the model, the interface, then the real generator will connect it to the generator test project inspector, the generator here. Okay, and then you can create a display, very simple one. You just display the vendor status. Okay, so what you do is that through the model list, you find the display device. Okay, and you make a connection. Okay, and then the vendor status of the generator, the real generator, will send the data, which is received by step talk, and you will show the data. Okay, through the monitoring window or other 分析 graphical figures, so something like that. Okay. Now, we can describe the types of acceptance tests. Basically, there are three types. The self test involves the IoT device under test only. You just use one IoT device that you want to test, then you can conduct the testing procedure. And the second type is that you will test two IoT devices at the same time. One is sensor, one is actuator. Okay. And the third one is that you want to test an IoT device, but there is no way, okay, you can get a feedback, then you will use a visual test. Which means that you put a camera there to see what's going on. Okay. For the first test, we have conducted in a smart city. One is the Hsinchu International AI Smart Park, which will be managed by Acton, one of the largest ICT company in Taiwan. The revenue is US$1.85 billion in year 2020. We have a collaboration with Acton, okay, to manage the smart park in Hsinchu. And the spectral will be used by Acton to verify all smart applications in the park. And another example that we conduct is a smart building of China Medical University in Shenan Trade and Economy Park, which is in Taichung. You can see that there are very fancy smart building here. And here is the electric generator equipment that we will test. Okay, so for the generator, what we do here is that remember that in the previous slide, okay, we have this generator, and now we will do a more complete testing. Then what happened here is that we have generator's output, okay, device, meaning that you can control input and output. Okay, actually the battery status, oil status, and vent status, okay, which are input device that will produce information to our test procedure. But the generator also have output device that you can control. For example, the generator switch and the vent switch. Okay, through the test procedure, actually you can turn on the generator. Okay, so the generator has two parts. One is the sensor, one is the actuator, meaning the switch. And in the input test procedure, the input will be switch one and switch two. We connect the switch to the generator and the vent switch. Okay, and then the test output will receive the value from the generator's status, sensor status, and also the switch to see that if you have turned on or turned off. You'll see what's going on here. Okay, then what happened here is that you can create a test sequence, or you can manually control the switch 1 and switch 2 to see whether the generator switch or burn switch behave exactly normally do what you ask to do. Okay. So the switch I2, okay, the number 1 and 3 here turn on the generator's switch. Okay. Now, the validation is performed by test output through the test output procedure here, the device here. They include the battery, the oil, the vent. Okay. And also, the switch 1 and 2, if we turn on, we also receive this information. Okay. And then in this test procedure, based on the information we receive in the switch O1, okay, we can see that if the battery status, oil status has been changed. Okay, suppose you turn on the switch, then the battery should be changed, and the oil should be changed. And similarly, you can do the same thing for the vent. Okay, so the spec in the spec. Emulation, spectral emulation. The test input automatically generates sequence of test signal through random number generators. We can also use pre-stored test vector as input sent to the test engine. The test procedure is developed manually through the GUI, which minimizes the programming effort. We do it at the first time. Then the procedure is saved in spectral to be reused for similar test cases in the future. Suppose that the oil consumption rate is given in the vendor's data sheet. If the tank is full, then it will be consumed below the threshold, say in 15 minutes. Then we can do the test procedure. Okay, just let the generator to run 15 minutes and then see if the oil status I will give an alert after 15 minutes. Okay, and this is done automatically. So you don't need to wait there for 15 minutes to receive the result. You just let the test procedure to automatically do the job for you. Another example is self-test configuration for water cooler chillers. In the Tychus specification, there is a two-parameter IDF called chiller water F feature, okay? Water flow, actually, WF means water flow, chiller water flow, okay. And there are two parameters for the for this sensor. One is PLN, and the other is the percentage, okay. So in the device feature window, this device feature actually has two parameters, okay. Previously, when we mentioned this device feature, there's only one parameter, like temperature or humidity and so on. But here, there are some device feature that have multiple parameters. Okay. Another example is GPS coordinates. Okay. That device feature will have three parameters. Okay. Or two parameters. If that's in a XY space. Or in a 3D space, there will be a three parameters. Okay. So the IDF, okay, we call it a CHWF, that's a short name. It's created through the device feature management, like what we did in a previous example, except that we set the parameter number to be 2. So here, there's a number of parameter you can set, and you say 2. The first parameter is a sensor that measures the water flow rate in liter per minute. So the unit is LPM. And then in this chiller machine, okay, the maximum is 10 LPM. And the minimum is 0. Okay. And then you have this sensor to measure the position of a water supply valve. Okay. So it's a measure in percentage. Okay. So the valve can be in the 50%. Okay, 80% or 90%. So the value range from 0 to 100, and the unit is percent. is a percentage, okay? And the second parameter, as we mentioned, is mentioned, okay? Now, the ODF is called CHSV control. It's a position control switch of the water supply valve, okay? So you can turn the water supply valve to some degree, okay? In some percentage, then the water flow will be controlled by the valve, okay? So here, we have, again, it's percentage, okay, from 0 to 100%, okay? So in this way, we can create a device feature for the water chiller device model. And then we can come out with a test procedure, okay? This test procedure is created through an IoT project called WC Chiller Test. In this project, the spec talk automatically generate the control signals through the test input, which is called test CHSVC control I. Okay, this is the number one here. And you will turn on the CHSVC SV control O. Okay, so the cheater has the valve that you can control. And in 4 and 5, it's a output of our test procedure. We'll check that if the watermark, the position, and the percentage, water flow percentage, correspond to the actual operation. Okay, so this is a very simple test procedure. Now let's go to a mutual test. The mutual test consists of one sensor and one actuator. And in this smart room, okay, we have the window control, where the CO2 sensor is A here, will control electric window. If the CO2 concentration is too high, then you open the window. So the test procedure for this application, okay. Sorry, I think I go to the wrong direction. So the CO2 level is too high, the window is triggered to open through the control path 3 to 2, okay? So the CO2 concentration will control the window, okay? And then through the test output, the number 4 here, we can observe if the CO2 level can be limit below a value. So in the window control, in this smart application, you have to guarantee that the CO2 concentration will limit it to the value, for example, below 400. Okay. Then the test output will see if during the test period, the CO2 concentration reading is always less than 400. If it's higher than, higher than 400, say 800, that means the test failed. Okay. And also in the emulation mode, SpecTalk can generate a design sequence to turn on and off the window through switch I. Then when switch O is 1, then test output check if the CO2 value decrease. Okay. So there are many ways you can design to implement your test procedure. Another example for mutual test is a greenhouse in the Hsinchu farm that we built. So the number one and number two, number one is a fan, it's an actuator. Number two is a dripping system that drip water. Okay. And then number three is a sensor, is a microwave station. We create a mutual test compilation to investigate if the farming sensors and the actuators interact correctly. The farming sensor include those for soil humidity, temperature, and wind speed, which is number 5, number 7, and number 9. And the actuators include the fans and the drippers, is number 2 and number 4. And the test input, again, we have switch 1 and switch 2 that control the actuators, okay, that serve to the ground truth to the test case. So when switch 1 turn on, you will trigger 3 bursts at 12 a.m. This is what happened here in February 4, 2019. Okay, so you can see the point, and you see the time series for the soil moisture and the soil temperature. And you can see that if you turn down the dripping system, the water will go to the soil. So the temperature drop. So the temperature sensor pass. Okay. But for the humidity, okay, it continues to drop. So that means that the moisture sensor failed. Okay. Because the temperature sensor behavior is correct, that means the dripping system also operation normally. Okay, so the only failure device is the moisture sensor. Similarly, we can test the fan and the wind speed sensor. Okay, and what we do here is that at the 11:25 a.m., we turn down the fan and turn it off at 2 p.m., 2:24 p.m. Okay, so you can see that the wind sensor goes high and goes down. And this is correct. So the test is passed. Now, let's take a look on the visual test. When the actuator cannot be evaluated by a self-test or a mutual test, we can observe its behavior visually. For example, when we use a smartphone to generate a sequence of test pattern, which is number one here, and then this sequence will lock or unlock a door, and you can see this the lock will change from its position here. Okay, and if we don't have a video camera, then we don't know what's going on unless you have someone just stand behind the lock to see its change. Okay. So what we do here is that we'll install a camera. And typically, you already have camera in the room anyway. And you are positioned to the lock. And then all those images you are sent to an AI. And it's very often that we use this YOLO AI module to do the recognition. And then you go to the test procedure to compare with the test pattern, and you got some test result. So this is a very simple ideas here. We have done those real tests on a park, okay? We conduct in the fountain in the Minder High School in Taichung. In this example, the monitoring camera is used to test multiple actuators, such as sprinklers, that's number one here. Okay, you want to see the springs here. Okay, so there's a sprinkler. And there's also the street light. Okay, street lamp. Okay, so there's a street lamp. And what we do here is that when we turn on the sprinklers, okay, so there's supposed to be 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, actually there's 5. Okay, there's 4. Okay, you will see a 4 sprint. Okay, and then in this position, YOLO will recognize that there is a 5 waters currents. Okay, if you don't detect all those 4 water currents, then you say the test fail. Okay, and the connection is something like that. Okay, it involves number 3, the switch. You turn on the switch. The test input will automatically generate the on-off pattern. And this battery will go to number 4 to control the sprinklers in the fountain. Okay, and then the switch status, the on-off status, will also send to number 8. Okay, it's a sprinkler 1. Okay, and 2, 3, 4. You want to see that all those 4, if you have actually turned on and off. okay, and then through this configuration, okay, you can see test output from the YOLO as well as the input pattern. Okay, so here the input test input will generate the input pattern, and the YOLO will input the result of the condition, and these two results will be compared and then send out to the test output. And for the lamp, we do that during the night. Okay, the lamp test is conducted at night, where white lamps are expected to be detected by YOLO. And at this moment, the lamp testing turn off, and then you turn on, then the YOLO should detect the white light spot. And the configuration, including the switch one, okay, then you go to the lamp switch, and you also go to the lamp test output, okay, and the YOLO will detect the lamp. Okay, in this way, you can see that the whether the result is correct. And another visual test that typical very often we use is on the factory. In the factory, there are many machines, and the meters are analog, they're very old one. There's no way you can digitize it. Then what you do is that you use a camera to get the image of these meters. Then you can read the meters through the YOLO recognition. Okay, so this is a very popular example that can do that we can do the test. Okay, so there are several comments on visual test. The learn test in the example we given, learn test is conducted during night, where the switch are automatically turned on and off. And the YOLO already knows the specific spots on the test in the picture, and therefore can be accurately detect the change on this spot. Okay, when we use the YOLO AI module, okay, we will need to worry about the accuracy. Okay, but since the spot is already accurately positioned, so the change detected by the YOLO is almost 100%. There's no problem. Okay. And last point is that we can conduct multiple tests simultaneously in one video screen. For example, the lamps and sprinklers in the middle high school, we just do the test at the same time. Okay, the YOLO can detect those objects, multiple objects at the same time. So this is a very good feature of YOLO. And Taikersi already have several partners, including the Telecommunication Technology Committee in Japan. And the Telecommunication Industry Association in USA, this is TIA, and IEEE, and China Communication Standard Association, CCSA, and ETSI in Europe, AIIB, in Japan, and TSDSI in India, and Malaysia, Technical Standards Foreign PhD, this so-called NTSFB, and TTA, Telecommunication Technology Association, that's in Korea. Okay, that's all about my talk. Thank you.